Feast TV is brought to you with the support from Missouri Wines, IKEA, Caldi's Coffee, Old Time Produce, and the Raphael Hotel.
Farms aren't just in the country anymore. Today, we're exploring urban agriculture. I'm Cat Neville, and this is Feast TV. Farms aren't only in the country, they are an increasingly common sight in the city as well. So today, we are exploring urban agriculture. We're going to be visiting a rooftop farm that's made possible through innovative architecture. We're going to visit a small teaching farm that's carved out of an urban area. And our first stop in this episode is at a fully off-the-grid farm where ideals and produce are thriving. Never know it, but I am standing in the urban core of Kansas City, Missouri, and today you are going to meet Brooke and Dan, two people who are setting the standard for what it means to run an urban farm.
I had been living in San Francisco and traveling all over the world and coming into my own, trying to figure out the meaning of life, I tell people. In order to sustain my travels, I worked on organic farms in exchange for room and board. And that kind of, for the first time in my life, grounded me, gave me something to focus on, gave me a passion that I felt was actually worthwhile. About 10 years ago, I moved back to Kansas City, started a small farm. I wanted to feed myself and sell the excess. 2 years into that, my now husband Dan joined me and we sort of tripled our production and we were making a living off it. You know, this tiny little acre area was making about $30,000 a year in vegetables, so it was lucrative. Unfortunately, not all our neighbors were as excited about it as we were. Basically, our neighbors decided that the presence of a farm or a large garden would bring down their property values. And they approached the city and they told us that if their property values plummeted, it would allow poor black families to move into their neighborhood and that our farm needed to be abolished. And it got extremely ugly, turned into a huge sort of blowout between community gardeners and food activists, environmentalists like us, versus the bourgeois. You know, I don't know how else to put it. It, you know, became about social justice. It became about personal empowerment. You know, the racism piece and the discrimination was just unthinkable. So we fought back, and long story short, we were forced to move on from that farming situation. We were planning on leaving Kansas City, but lo and behold, we found this 13 and a half acre piece of blighted, you know, underutilized land, and we fought the city to purchase it, which is its own very, very long story. The city spent $20,000 a year to keep this property mowed for over 20 years. That's a lot of money. When we purchased the land, the first year we were on it, we grew $40,000 worth of food. So it just goes to show, when I say, you know, land is wasted or underutilized, it truly is. And not only is it wasted, it's a strain on the people living in the city. In 6 years that we've been here, we've grown about close to $400,000 worth of food on this property without water or electricity. When we purchased the land, it was completely raw. We had to put in fencing. We started a citywide composting program. We spent 4 years building an off-grid water system. The farm is essentially self-sustaining. So, I mean, it's pretty wild and pretty awesome. And basically unheard of in any city across America. So this was our spring vegetable field. and a lot of these beds have been turned over and we're planting fall stuff in here. So there's sweet potatoes there, there's salad turnips, these are black Spanish radishes under here, watermelon radishes under the row cover, and more varieties of turnips. And finally, there are leeks peeking out of the weeds there. So,
I mean, things are growing everywhere on this farm.
Yeah.
I mean, no matter where you step, there is something that's alive.
Right. It's just sort of an edible oasis, and there's just so many layers of life everywhere.
How did you learn this?
We sort of taught ourselves, and yeah, it did take years to develop our systems and perfect them, and every day we're still developing, perfecting.
And you're financially sustainable. I mean, yeah. You're making a profit.
Amazingly so. Every single penny we make goes back into the farm. Every little piece of infrastructure you see on the farm, it was all paid for with beets and turnips grown on this land.
It's been a process. It's been a long process.
I try not to put a lot of meaning onto it as far as what it means, you know, sort of socially or in this larger context. I try to focus on what it means for us, what it means for our livelihood and our life.
This is where our family is. This is our land. This is something that we take care of all aspects of it.
So we have a passive solar earth-firmed home. I tell people it's kind of like a modern-day hobbit house. That's the hobbit house.
It is so cute.
Stan's masterpiece. It's built with all natural materials as much as the city would let us, so it's almost 100% non-toxic.
Wow, this is beautiful.
It's covered with earth, and it's incredibly insulative. So we have no heating or cooling. We have a wood-burning cook stove, composting toilet, and it's like nothing you would see anywhere. So it's unfinished, but it's
beautiful.
It's beautiful. And the view, I mean, you can't.
No, it's gorgeous.
We're not wealthy people, but whenever I see that view, I feel wealthy.
You built that. You didn't have to buy it.
Yes, I agree. We're into living simply, giving back more than we take. And that fuels us, that gives us purpose. And I know that's not how everyone works, but that's how we work. That's what makes us happy.
I'm inspired by this, what you've built here and the amount of effort that you've put in to reclaim the land, to give back to the community. I think what you've done is incredibly special.
Thank you.
You should be very, very proud of it.
Thank you so much.
The Columbia Center for Urban Agriculture is an innovative farm program that brings agriculture to the people of Columbia, Missouri. And today we are going to be meeting its director.
We're here at the Columbia Center for Urban Agriculture's Urban Farm. It's just north of downtown in central Columbia. We started at the University of Missouri by composting food scraps from one of the dining halls on campus. We were bringing food scraps to community gardens around Columbia, you know, really as a way of recycling. We've been at this site since 2010. We're just now finishing up our seventh growing season. And most of the food that we grow, we donate to local food pantries. So this urban farm is 1.3 acres right here in the middle of Columbia, and it's an educational site. The main purpose of the urban farm is to teach people. So when we grow the food, we work with volunteers and service learners, and people who are out here volunteering and learning can take that back in their own life and replicate it. Food and gardening are also a way to build community. when people are outside and gardening, they're meeting their neighbors, they're keeping an eye on what's happening in the community, and the social ties get stronger. So it really brings people together.
How many people work on the farm?
So the organization has about 12 staff. So not working just here at the farm, but throughout the communities, at schools and at families' homes. Last year we had about 300 volunteers.
Wow.
So college students, church groups, retirees, all different kinds of people who come out, and we get a lot of community support that way.
That's awesome. Oh, look at your peppers. Those are happy.
Yeah, the sweet potatoes are starting to encroach.
The sweet potatoes are like, this is my area.
They're like, hey peppers, what are you doing?
So what drives your decision for what you're gonna put in the ground? Is it what you think people are interested in eating, or is it what you want to teach people about? How do you determine?
That's a great question. Since most of the food we grow goes to the food pantry, we've taken feedback from the customers at the pantries where we drop off. So it's really changed over the years based on the wants and the needs of the families at the pantry.
The Columbia Center for Urban Agriculture is not only operating right here in this location, they also have farms throughout the city of Columbia, and we're gonna go check some of those out. So I've never seen a crate garden before. I didn't even know that this was possible.
Yeah, well, you can do anything. I mean, urban agriculture is about possibilities. And so this crate garden right here at Lucky's Market is something that we started 2 years ago with the help of Lucky's. We call it the Crates to Plates Garden. Everything that we grow here is donated to local food pantries and other hunger relief outlets in Columbia. It embodies urban agriculture so well because it's portable. Mm-hmm. We can pick up these crates and take them anywhere. We're right here on top of concrete growing food. And given that urban agriculture can be kind of transient, growing in crates makes it pretty easy.
So all these businesses in Columbia can reach out to your organization, and you guys will partner with them to build farms or gardens wherever it is that they want.
That's right. We try to meet people where they're at. So if somebody wants help starting a garden at their home or their business, we can be there to help them do what needs to get done.
And I think next up, we're going to be going to a pharmacy where you guys are growing a ton of food for another pantry.
That's right. Vegetables are the best medicine.
That's amazing. Let's go.
So we are at the Kilgore's Community Garden. It is a garden that was started by the Kilgore's Pharmacy here in Columbia. So after the pharmacy started the garden, they came to us and asked us to help them manage it and maintain it. All the food that's grown here at the garden gets donated to a low-income daycare just down the street.
I love that the goal of this farm is education. I mean, to me, that's what really makes it so special. Because when you approach a project like this from the angle of education, as opposed to just being a farm stand and selling great produce to people, then you really spread this idea so much farther than if all you were doing is growing and providing really beautiful food to people.
We have the opportunity to add so much value to what we do by bringing other people into the process and provide them with experiences that a lot of people just wouldn't get otherwise. Everybody eats. And so if there's anything in the whole world that brings us all together, it's food. You can sit down at a table and you can break bread with a complete stranger, but you have that in common. It's really a community building tool.
Welcome to Urban Harvest STL. This is an urban rooftop garden that is situated right on the edge of downtown St. Louis. We're going to meet its founder today and find out how this nonprofit was created.
So Urban Harvest STL started in about 2011, and our first project was a community garden. We just wanted to start growing food in the neighborhood. And since then, we've scaled up, and now we have an urban farm. We still have a space for people living in the neighborhood to grow their own food for themselves and their families. But the rest of the farm is essentially managed by our farm manager and interns and volunteers. And the majority of the food actually goes to our partners in the community that help us get the healthy food into the hands of people that don't necessarily have access to it. I'm actually a recovering architect rather than designing buildings per se. Now I'm designing community spaces on top of buildings. So I'm really cross-pollinating agriculture and architecture.
So you're an architect. What was your vision for this?
The design of the food roof really revolved around our interest in making this a community experience. So front and center, where the best view is of downtown and city museum, that's where we created this community hub space where we can host different events. And we really wanted a farm to be surrounding that area so people really got a unique experience.
How did you decide what you wanted to grow? I see a lot of peppers and eggplant.
There are a lot of peppers and eggplant. We're actually growing over 100 varieties of plants up here. So
wow.
Primarily vegetables, a lot of herbs, some flowers as well.
What's the volume that you can produce up here?
We expect it to be way over 3,000 pounds at the end of the year. And each year as we get better and better at this, we expect that number to grow.
That's amazing. All of your herbs, they're beautiful. Everything is just so healthy looking.
So farming on a rooftop is actually quite a bit different than traditional farming on the ground. We only have 8 inches of soil up here. So we're learning how to grow in less soil. We're learning how to grow with less water. We're trying to be as efficient as we can. So there's some disadvantages, but the advantage is we can grow food anywhere for growing on a rooftop. So this is the green roof system that we're standing on top of.
Oh. Essentially,
this is the roof membrane, just like any building would have. This is a capillary fleece, and on top of that is what you call a retention board. So these 4x4 cups are laid out across the entire roof, and they capture rainwater. So anytime it rains, we capture about 2.5 inches of rain, and that equates to about 17,000 gallons of water across the rooftop.
It's just an amazing system. I mean, when you walk up, it just looks like a bunch of happy plants sitting on a roof, but it's a really complicated.
It's more than just throwing soil on a roof and going from there. There's a lot of a thought and intention behind it.
What is this?
This is a vertical garden. It's a new vertical growing system that leverages these garden socks that are full of lightweight soil.
Why did you choose to grow specifically the greens on the wall?
Primarily because of the space limitation.
Oh, okay.
We don't have enough depth to grow root vegetables, obviously, and with greens, we figured we could, you know, cut and come again and just get a constant harvest out of them. This is a greenhouse. This is where we propagate our crops before we put them out in the fields. And then on the other side, we grow microgreens that we then sell to some nearby restaurants as an additional revenue stream for our organization. There's nothing better than watching a chef come up here and see their eyes light up. The idea of literally picking fresh herbs to garnish their plates that they're then serving directly to people, I mean, it doesn't get any more local or more fresh than that.
You taste a little bit like a sunflower seed, but with kind of that green, almost chlorophyll flavor to it. I love those things.
I love putting them on pizza with hot sauce.
Oh.
There's nothing better than hot sauce and microgreens on pizza. I'm just saying.
You're coming from an architecture field and you're kind of melding that passion with wanting to create something that really is going to benefit
The community.
What is the feeling that you get by doing this work?
It is immensely gratifying. I think the best part is just all the wonderful people that are engaged in this project and, you know, the impact that we're having by getting the food to people that need access to healthy food and then building a community of educated people that are engaged in the local food system. We're We're doing so much more than just growing food up here. It's an education platform, so we host a lot of events and opportunities for people to get engaged. It's the first rooftop farm in downtown St. Louis, and we just want to continue to grow urban farms and serve the community in that way.
So today I decided I was going to make a pie, an Italian pie specifically, this one using Swiss chard and kale and eggs and a lot of herbs. This is the kind of stuff that you would definitely find growing in any number of urban settings. So this pie is very traditional. It is typically served at Easter time, but really you can make it at any time of the year, and it's hearty and it's delicious and it's vegetarian. So I'm gonna get started by chopping up my Swiss chard and my kale, and then an onion. This recipe is really easy, and it's very dramatic. It's kind of a fun thing to be able to serve. Nice big pie with these layers of green and white, and these egg yolks. Wait till you see the way it comes together. It's really fun. So this is my one yellow onion, chopped up. Just gonna saute this until it's nice and soft. You want to make sure that you're using a nice big skillet for this because you're going to dump in all of those greens. I'm going to put in the kale first because it's much more dense than the chard, and get it wilted, and then I'll add the chard as well. And everything's looking nice and wilted, not overcooked, but nice and soft. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this over to the sink and put everything in a colander just to have any excess moisture drain off. And I'm gonna put it in this nice big bowl. Alrighty, so I have my kale and charred onion mixture here in this bowl. I'm gonna spread it out a little bit so it starts to cool down. You want it not to be screaming hot when you add in the other ingredients. The other ingredients being some dill, a little bit of thyme, and also some parsley. I'm gonna chop all this stuff up and toss it in. Herbs, eggs, greens, and cheese. This is a perfect springtime meal. And if you do happen to make it for Easter or something like that, it's really great on a buffet because you can have it room temp or cold. The next addition to our beautiful greens mixture will be half a cup of Parmigiano Reggiano, but I'm gonna be adding more to an additional cheese layer, so I'm gonna grate about a full cup of this beautiful cheese. All right, so half of this goes into the greens. The other half I'm putting in this bowl here. I'm gonna beat a couple of eggs and add those to the greens as well. There are 10 eggs in this recipe, so make sure you have enough on hand. Pour that right in. And then I'm gonna add some allspice and nutmeg to taste. Now I'm just gonna mix all this stuff up and set it aside while I make my cheese mixture. So this is my half a cup of Parmigiano Reggiano, and this is a cup and a half of ricotta cheese. And in Italy, the cheeses that are used have a little bit of a tang to them, so to help kind of mimic that flavor, I'm adding in about a quarter of a cup of just some Greek yogurt. So I'm gonna set the cheese mixture aside. I'm gonna clean all this up because next I'm rolling out the puff pastry. Puff pastry does need to be thawed a little bit when you take it out of the freezer. You don't want it to be hard as a rock, but you also don't want it to be totally thawed out because then it'll just get gloppy on you. I'm just gonna sprinkle a little bit of flour. So this pie has a bottom and a top crust. I want to make sure that my dough is big enough to drape over the sides and go into the crevices of this springform pan. And make sure you use the springform pan. Don't just use a regular pie plate because you need it to be this deep. Easy way to move pie dough, roll it around your rolling pin. Cut the edge is just roll your rolling pin right across the surface and just pull off the excess. First layer I'm putting in is our greens, and these have cooled down. You don't want to put it in when it's warm because it'll just make the bottom super soggy. Next up, our layer of ricotta, enhanced with just a little bit of that yogurt. This is the fun part. I just put 7 divots in the top of my ricotta. And what I'm gonna do is put 7 egg yolks in those divots. Last step, I'm just gonna roll out the top crust and brush it with an egg wash. All right, my oven's at 350. I'm putting this in for about 40 minutes. I always feel so accomplished when I pull something that's baked out of the oven. I love this. It smells wonderful. The puff pastry just has that buttery aroma. It's cooled for about 40 minutes. You want to make sure that you cool it thoroughly before you release it. And there we go. That is gorgeous. Awesome. This looks fantastic. I cannot wait to dig into this. And I am pairing it with a dry vignole. Vignole is a fantastic grape that grows really well in the Midwest. And it has a kind of a sweet tart characteristic. Perfect pair with the herbal, cheesy, eggy richness of this pie. So the next time you're at your local urban farm, grab some greens and some eggs and whip up a fabulous pie. Cheers.